Hello dear students, welcome to the lecture 12 of Object Oriented Programming with C# course. So let's start with composing a new VPF.NET project. As you know already, this is actually .NET Core, but it is now named as .NET. All right. Here I have selected our folder, lecture 12. Okay, so I will be try to fast this week. We have already seen thread and what is thread, and I will make a quick example of thread and updating a user interface inside thread from thread. I don't suggest you to use thread unless you explicitly need to do it, need to use threads because tasks are much better option. Tasks are newer technology and therefore you should always use tasks instead of threads. However, just to give you an idea. Okay. So okay. Let's have a label here to update it. All right, so let's make this counter. Okay, so I will copy paste my code from previous year. Okay, let's say we want to update the user interface and display clock. Okay, on the screen with let's say 100 millisecond interval. You see this threading thread sleep will sleep that particular thread it is currently running in. Currently this button click is running in the main UI thread, main window thread. Therefore it will freeze my screen and I will see nothing. Okay. You see, screen is frozen. I am seeing nothing. Okay, and I can use dispatcher to fix this problem. Okay. However, let's check it out. Still, my screen is freezing because even though I use dispatcher begin invoke, now this time this while loop is blocking my main thread, if not only this one but also the while itself. Therefore, I need to take this inside a task or thread. So let's write another method. Update clock on screen. You see this can be a static because I don't need I will not need instance of it. However, if I make it like this, you see I am not able to access instance access the label itself. So I have to provide this method an instance like main of let's say window, and from this reference I can access the label itself. Okay, and I will start this inside a thread like this thread, and for using threads I need to add using system threading. Okay, thread, and let's call this my thread, and here my thread start update, and now let's see how it works. Okay, oh by the way, it is expecting a reference of main window. I am just providing this because this in this case is the main window itself. Cannot convert from window to system using parameterized thread start. Oh, I see. So to be able to do parameterized thread start, okay, I think what we need is you see, if it was a task, it would already be working. However, to be able to do parameterized thread start, okay, so its name is parameterized thread start, I think. Interesting. This is another good example, perhaps. Okay, passing data to threads. How it is done? New thread starts. I see. And here, I will use new thread start like this. Okay, is it still expecting something? It is still expecting. Let's check. Void target. Interesting. New parameterized thread start, perhaps. None of these are good examples. Let's look for the Stack Overflow. Okay. So it is like this. Oh, but okay, this is the important thing. I will also show you this.
This is a handy way of calling methods that don't fit the thread start or parameterized thread start delegate, but be careful that you can easily cause a data race if you change the arguments in the parent thread after passing them to the child thread's code.
Okay, and oh, this is the way it is. Okay, and here we will provide this perhaps new thread, new parameterized thread start like this, and here This is task. Okay, I don't need task. Oh, it takes like this. Okay, let's make it like this then. Okay, it is expecting object, not a specific object type. Therefore, I will make it like this, and I will convert running window equal to main window like this, and I see I have to explicitly. Okay, now it should work. Now we did parameterize the thread start. You see now it is working as expecting and updating. If I click again, the number of threads increases. However, it is still getting updated at the same speed, I think. Yeah, okay. All right, and what else we can do? We can change the properties of threads, like long running thread or background thread. You see there is is background thread, is thread pool thread, and there is priority of the thread. There is, you see, there are also extra things like suspend, resume, start, thread state, and such. These are all thread extensions. Okay, there is something else I have seen here which is important, I think. It is called as race conditions. I will make an example related to this so you can understand, because it is really important. You see, when we are working with threads or tasks that is executed and the next line started immediately, so if you change that parameter in the parent thread, that parameter may be changed before given to your method. What I mean is, now I will show you an example of it. Let's call this as data race when threading. Okay. Tasking. Okay, this is fine. And to illustrate this, we can use the counter label as well. It is fine. And okay, let's compose a click event. Okay, this time I will be using task factory because it is better. Task factory, it is task factory. I think for to be able to use it, okay, we are already using tasks. Why task factory is not task factory? Interesting, why using system running task factory? Task dot factory start new. Okay, like this. And this way I will start a new task. Okay, let's write another method. Let's say display number. Okay. And it will just update the user interface with the number. Okay, I still need reference for main window, you see. So let's make this something like this. I will static main window running window ref. Okay, it will be by default null, and after the initialization of the window, I will assign it to this, as you can see. And therefore, I will be able to use it anywhere I want, like this. And it will just display the number on the screen. Okay. And zero. So this is a simple method that takes an integer number and shows it on the label. Okay. Oh, okay. So let's first start and make an example, like 200. Okay, something like this. It is not important. Oh, we didn't put the semicolon here. So this is starting another, starting a task. Oh, it was too big, I guess. Okay. If you exit maximum integer number, it will be too big. Yeah, let's provide the max in. Okay, not, it's not important. Let's first do it like this. Okay, it is working. Then let's say we have a number variable. Okay, integer type, and we are passing it through instead of a number directly. Okay, it is provided as it is. And let's say under this task, I am modifying this number. Okay, something like this. So there may be a data race right now, and the number, when the task started, the number may have already changed in the parent thread. Okay, so let's try to achieve that. You see, I am seeing 10. Why? Because I have provided here this number, however, I have seen 10. Do you know why? Because that thread, until that thread is started here, this number is already changed here. Okay, so this is what is data racing. When you are working in a multi-threaded project, you may come to this problem and you may not be aware of it. Your parameters. So let me show you what I mean. So I will put a breakpoint here, and you will see that we are indeed providing the other number. You see, the number is currently like this. However, this line is immediately executed, and then this line is executed. Okay. Therefore, until this thread is starting, the number is being changed here in the parent thread. This is called as data racing. Okay, so let's add this link to the let's add link of this to link of this data racing to our project. Okay, so I will add this link. So how can I prevent data erasing? Okay, in this particular example, it is easy actually. What I can do is, let's add another button to show how to prevent data erasing. By the way, do you understand why this is happening? This is happening because task factory start new. This line is immediately executed before, without waiting task to start and execute. Okay, this is what is about multi-threading. It doesn't block your flow of your thread. The task starts. Okay. All right. And now let's make example of preventing data erasing. Okay. So how do we prevent data erasing? Okay. All right. So let's say I'm copying and pasting the same example, and task, and here I can use wait. However, if I use wait, it will wait until the task completes its execution. Okay, so this is not what I want. What I want is I need to wait until the task is started. Okay. Okay. So from the task's status, we will wait until it is equal to running. So to do that, while true, okay, if status equal task dot, or let's say task status in this case dot. You see there are run to completion, running. Okay, this is what we need. If it is running, we will just break. However, if it gets to completed status too fast, then we need to break again, run to completion. Or let's say if it is not equal to waiting for activation, okay, we will just do a while, and inside this while we can add a just 1 millisecond delay. Okay, so with this way, with this polling approach, we can make sure that correct number is being displayed. Okay, so now we have another problem. Okay, the not waiting for activation, but waiting to run. Okay, this is the thing We need to wait. Waiting to run. Not the activation. Okay, let's try again. Once the task starts running, it should have updated. It should have the initial number. Okay, not this one as again as well. So what is the initial task status? Okay. It is waiting to run, I guess. Okay, you see it has waited, therefore. So I will do an example. Debug write line. This is for testing purposes. We are task status to string. So we will see the task's status and how it is changing. By the way, this will freeze our application right now. However, we will get the idea. But it will be too fast, I think. Okay, run to completion. So if it's run to completion, we need to break the while. Break, okay. So now we can see the state the task has gone through until the status is run to completion. Okay, let's check the output. Okay, so first it was waiting to run, then it is running. Okay. So I guess we need to wait until it is running, not waiting to run. Okay, so if it is like this or this, I will break. We can still add a delay here. It would make our application consume lesser CPU. Okay, this is minimum milliseconds. This is a primitive way of solving problem, but still not solved. This is interesting. Okay, let's check it out. Okay. Okay, there are three thread start and thread start. Task factory start, yes, this is what we are doing right now. Okay, there is thread join, I know that, but this is not what we want. Yeah, we know that. Okay, so the continue with could be, but it is, it will be still, none of these. Not this one as well. Okay, none of these what I want. This is not what we want as well. Oh, I see. I see what we can do. ifade set this to a local variable, this shouldn't make a difference, but let's try this. Because the time of update between the user interface and the thread status. Okay, now this is working. Okay, so we have to assign this to a local variable to make sure that we are keeping the number we are getting from the method. Okay, let's try this many times and see the result. Oh, okay, it appears that sometimes this is not still synchronized. Okay. So we can use thread lock, however, it would lock our application forever. Okay, so it looks like the best way would be having a synchronization item like. Parameters pass it equals to false. Boolean is a thread safe object type, therefore once I set it true, it is atomic. Okay. See. So Boolean is also not thread safe, I think. Therefore, what we need to do is oh, we are not able to lock it, therefore it should be thread safe object. It is interesting why they are saying it is not thread safe. Static bool stop, thread start. Okay, new thread start, thread sleep, stop. Static void thread jump, int count, while stop. Listen, okay. I see. So to be able to make sure that we are synchronizing between the Boolean, we need also locking object. Okay, so what we are going to do is we will lock stop. We will use this lock object for parameter pass. And this will make our software make this a thread safe. What I mean is, I will show you. So here I will lock it, and if Our method passes equal to true. I will break it. Then I can add. Okay, this will be 100% thread safe. Because when you lock an object, until this lock is freed, you cannot lock it again and read it again. So whenever this thread, this method tries to read this object, it will wait, it will lock it. Okay. So when it is locked here, I won't be able to read it here. Or it is locked here, I won't be able to lock here. Therefore, whenever this Boolean parameter is accessed, it will be every time synchronized. So this is what locks do. Locking objects will give you, let's say, synchronization. Okay. And this is the most common way using of locking. You compose an object type, read-only object type, object, a parameter, a field, and you lock it. This is the fastest way. So this way, it will be 100% always synchronized. Therefore, we will set this parameter read to true after we have assigned number to a local variable, and this way we will be preventing data erasing. You see, once this parameter is set to true, my further clicks are not making it wait, so it works for only the first time. Therefore, I have to set it false whenever I click this button. So now you will see it is synchronized every time. Okay, it will be synchronized every time. The other way would be waiting this task to finish. However, if you wait for a task to finish, it is not anymore multi-threading, because that thread will be still blocked. What I mean is, I could do wait, and if I do this, this will still block the parent thread. Thread, and therefore, in this case, our application would, let's say, freeze. What I mean is, I can add a while through here, and it can do, okay, system threading, thread, sleep, 1 second. Okay, so, with task wait enabled, you will see that my screen is frozen because it will be forever waiting this task to finish. Okay, and it will never finish because it has a infinite while loop. You see, my screen is frozen, and therefore this will not work in this particular case. Okay, this would ensure that the rest of the code is executed until this task is finished. Okay. However, it will work as usual right now until the task completely executed. Therefore, okay. Let's fix this word. Okay. Okay, now you see the data arrays and threads and tasks. What else there is? Is and as operators. Okay. Okay, we have seen that. Okay, is versus as operator keyword. Let's make example of that as well. By the way, you can start tasks inside another task and inside another task. So I could start another task inside this task and I can make them cascaded. It is totally fine. So the system design is totally up to you. I will show you more synchronization in the following lectures when I show example of multi-threaded crawling. These are simple examples right now. Please test them at your home. So let's continue with is and as operator. Before continuing, I will write the so far what we have seen. Okay, how to all right. That's okay, I think this is so far good. So now let's continue with is and as operator keyword. Oh, why? Okay, because we have used the incorrect keyword. All right. So let's delete this. And okay, it's fine. Okay. All right, so let's copy and paste it. So we have three classes. The base class is P and the derived class is P1 and we have another base class P2. So I will copy this example link and let's copy and paste this to see. So then we compose an instance of class P as O1 and then instance of P1 as O2. When we type is O1 is P, it is correct. Okay. Let's see with debugging. Okay. Okay, currently at the output screen it is clean. You see true. O1 is P. Checking whether O1 is type of object base class for all classes. True. Then checking O2 is P1. O2 is P1 because O2 is P1. It is true. Let's checking O2 is object. True. Then O2 is P1. True. Then O1 is P2. False. Why? Because O1 is type of P and P2 is a different base class, therefore it is false. Then O2 is P2. It is also false because P2 is different. So P and P1 are same. So when we check O1 and O2, we should get true, I think. Let's try. O1 is O2. Okay, O1 is P and O2 is P1. And let's try the opposite as well. Okay, it says a constant value is expected. Oh, I see. So we have to use a constant value. Therefore, I need to make this like P1, and because O1 is P and O2 is P. Let's try this. P, and let's see how they behave. And O2 is P. I'm not sure how will they return. So O1 is the base class and O2 is the derived class. So let's continue until here. Okay, the output is false. You see, O1 is the parent of P1, but they are not same. And O2 is derived of P and it is true. So if it is derived class, it says it is true. So P1 is P. However, P is not P1. Okay. P1, P, and in this case, O1, P, P1. Okay. All right. So we have seen the is test, and then let's make S test. Okay, so this is S test and then typecasting. Okay, so let's test S. This is operator in that case. Okay, let's continue. It is fine. Let's define another two classes, class I and Z. Or let's just compose another button to make it easier to read. So this is operator and is operator click. And we change this one. Then I will copy and paste it. So this time it will be as operator. Okay. Okay, here. And let's see the as operator itself. Okay, so we define an object array which holds five different objects. The first object is from I class, the second one is from Z class, third one is string, fifth one is double, and fourth is null. Okay, this is double, this is string, this is I, and this is Z. Okay, now we do a for loop and we use as operator and we use them as string. Okay, then if it is not null, this is a null check, I write them as debug write line, and then I will check this as string with is equal to null or not. Okay, so if it can be converted to string, it will not be null. Otherwise, it will be a null as expecting. So this is as conversation. So if that class supporting to string method, by the way, to string is a object extension for all object classes. Okay, so let's see, the first one is null because the I class doesn't support a string. Therefore, we will see as the output, you see, we see the name of I class like this, lecture12.mainwindow plus I. And if it is null, it will type as it is not a string. Then the second object, same, of course. Okay, then the third object will be string because it's already string. And the fourth object, let's see, it is still null. It can be converted to string, but it is still null. Therefore, we will see as it is not a string. And the fifth object will be okay, null. So this is what is about as. Okay, and I wonder if we can make another example. Let's try to get some formal information. Okay, this looks like a good example. Okay, look at the example given below. So we have a circle class which takes an integer as an input at the initialization. Then we compose an object O from C. So this is just reference assigning, and we explicitly convert O into integer I, and this compiles okay because it is from object class, however throws an exception. Okay, so let's read it.
Here the runtime is more suspicious. If the type of object in memory does not match the cast, the runtime will throw an invalid cast exception. We should be prepared to catch this exception and handle it appropriately if it occurs. However, catching an exception and attempting to recover in the event that the type of an object is not what we expected it to be is a rather cumbersome approach. C# provides two more very useful operators that can help us to perform casting in a much more elegant manner by using the is and as operators. Let's have some discussion of the operators.
Okay, so this example is better than what we have seen so far. You see, this is casting, and we are casting object O into integer. However, it is not from integer type, therefore it is giving an error. So,
is operator the is operator is used to check whether the runtime type of an object is compatible with a given type or not. In other words, we use the is operator to verify that the type of an object is what we expect it to be. Let's look at its syntax. Expression is type example of the is operator.
Okay, so we have two classes, class 1 and class 2, and we have another class is test, and here we are testing. So to do this test, I will compose a console application. It will be a better example. Okay, you see there is still console.app.NET Core. It is not named as .NET yet. And here, okay, let's name it as console. Okay, so let's define our classes. Inside class program, it's fine. And then we compose a method like this. So it takes as a object. And then let's write our test. So first we compose class 1. And then we compose class 2, then we pass them to the test. You see, since this is object and these are all classes are from object type, therefore it is fine. They are accepting C1 as object type here. Then let's run it. So in the class test, if O is class 1, so this is runtime testing. Okay, the is keyword is for runtime testing to prevent let's say to prevent exception happening. Okay, I could have do a casting without check and it would throw an error. What I mean is, so okay, it is fine working here, and let's do a casting here. Okay, class 1, C3, and from casting, let's cast it as class 1. From C2. Okay, so you see now it is giving an error. Therefore, what I'm doing is object C0 equal to C2. Then I cast it like this. So this will give runtime error. You see, it doesn't throw any compile error. Will throw runtime error. Let's run the application to see it. Okay, you see unable to cast. Let's type the error as well. So I need to only cast if I will check if C3 or let's say if C0 is class 2. I need to make this cast, okay. And okay, this is the correct way. Okay, and this will be false, therefore it will not throw any error. Let's run it. I need to close this. Okay, do you see? Oh, not C. So I need to check as class 1. Okay, let's restart. Okay, so it is working as expecting. Okay. Then the example continues.
In the above example, I'll be checking whether object O is a class or not. If the argument passed is not a class, then the application will jump to the message O is neither class 1 nor class 2. As operator. The as operator is used to perform conversions between compatible types. Actually, the as operator fulfills a similar role like is, but in a slightly truncated manner. Let's look at its syntax, expression as type example of the as operator.
Okay, so we have class 1 and class 2 again. And let's just copy and paste. Evaluate it. So here, okay, it is the same example as I have taken. And when we cast a string instead of just simply casting, this time it supports and it handles null casting. So if I do it like this, this is explicit casting. This will throw an error. Okay, let's run the application and see. Oh, not. I have written the syntax incorrectly. So if I make it like this, if I do explicit casting without checking, I will get an error. We handle null case casting. Okay, now you see the difference of as and explicit casting. Is operator. Okay, so okay, now you have the idea about what are they. All right, so we have seen the is and as casting. Okay. What is casting and as operator. Okay, what else there is? Okay, typecasting example. We have already seen that, but I think we can make more example. Okay, typecasting. Yeah, I will do that, but let me take a break for a while. So we will continue with typecasting, a more detailed example. I will show it on our VPF application. Okay, the click event here. Okay, what we are doing is, you see we have integer and this is implicit conversion typecasting with integer assigning to a long. And this is automatic type conversion with long to float. And we can display the result. Okay, so let's run the application until here. So long is bigger than integer, therefore it is possible to display all integer values as long. It is also possible for float, I guess. Okay, and let's see the output. Okay, they are fine. However, if I make this as integer max, let's see if it is still working. It should work. I will do something else as well. Okay, it is working. However, you see it is displayed a little bit differently with float value because floats are keeping data in the memory differently. Okay, therefore it is displayed like this. And if we look for it, okay, it is harder to read. And I will try something else. So this time, let's change this long to equal to long dot max value, then assign it to float. I wonder if it can hold the maximum value of long. Okay, let's test that. Okay, no error. Okay, so you see the maximum value of long is like this, and it is still able to hold that as a float. Then we have double here, and you see we are not able to assign double to integers because it says that cannot implicitly convert type double to int. Okay, therefore you need explicit conversion like here. Okay, so this should work. Let's run the application until here. This will work. However, it still depends on runtime conversion. Why? Because if it is double max, it will give runtime error. I will show you. You see, we have lost the numbers that is coming after the zero. So the floating points are reduced. If it was like this, for example, let's say 99, I think it is doing ceiling. Let's say this time, let's try this. And I will also test something else. Let's make this maximum of double. It should give runtime error. Okay. So let's run the application. Because we cannot convert max. Oh, it may not give. It may give some weird values. Yeah. It may give something like negative value. It's possible. If you exit the maximum value of integer, yeah, you see it is giving me negative of maximum negative of integer like this. And also this is also converted to this is equal to ceiling, okay, or floor. Floor versus ceiling. Let me remember that. Okay, so it is ceiling. Let's test it. Let's test and remember. These are important things when you are doing programming. You should always remember them to prevent hard to capture errors. Okay, because these are runtime errors and they are hard to capture. Okay, so the ceiling is like this. You see it increases value by one because it exists 0.5, and floor is like this. Okay. Okay, then we can do built-in type conversion with to string, to integer, to u, to unsigned integers and such. Okay, they would all work. Let's try it. So this is explicit and implicit casting type conversion. Okay, it is all working. All right, and what else? Okay, we have seen the interface, and from interface we have seen interfaces, but I am trying to see if anything important there. No, we are fine. We have seen interfaces enough. And let's check here. Okay, so symmetric encryption. All right, let's see about symmetric encryption as well. Okay, so Let's add another button. Let's first make asymmetric encryption. Okay, asymmetric encryption also known as hashing is also asymmetric encryption type. Okay, first make asymmetric encryption. Oh no no they are different. Okay, I am having a different thing. I have confused it with asymmetric encryption and hashing. We know the symmetric encryption, but what about asymmetric? Okay. Oh, it is about two. I see. Okay, let's first see the symmetric encryption, then do the asymmetric encryption. So we will have idea about both of them. Okay. And anything else? If there is, I think no. Yeah. So how much time? Okay.
Implement symmetric and asymmetric cryptography algorithms with C sharp. Keeping your users' data in a secure environment is a very important step while building an application, especially when you are dealing with sensitive information, such as emails, passwords, and e-payment information, bank accounts, payment cards, etc., and also when your application sends and receives the data over a network. In these situations, you have to be sure that no one can tamper with the data or steal it, and make your users feel comfortable while they are using your application because they know that their data is secure. In this article, I'll try to explain the differences between symmetric and asymmetric algorithms and how you can implement these algorithms in your app using C# programming language. So, what are symmetric and asymmetric algorithms?
Okay, about this symmetric and asymmetric cryptography, I am teaching them in the information security lecture, so you may want to watch them on the YouTube channel.
Before I start with symmetric and asymmetric algorithms, I'll explain cryptography in general. Cryptography is about encrypting and decrypting data. With encryption, you convert a plain text that's human readable into a random array of bytes. Decryption is the opposite process, you convert the random array of bytes into a plain text. Encrypting any piece of plain text needs a key to do the operation, and also, the decrypting process needs a key to convert encrypted data into a plain text. A key is the controller of the encryption process that is used by an algorithm. Actually, here is the main difference between symmetric and asymmetric strategies. A symmetric algorithm uses one key to encrypt and decrypt your data, however, the asymmetric algorithms use two different keys which are mathematically related to each other. One of these keys is public and can be used by everyone. The other key is private and it should be used only by you and never shared with anyone. Another difference between symmetric and asymmetric algorithms is the performance and size. Symmetric encryption is faster and used to encrypt a large data sets. Asymmetric is well suited for encrypting a small messages. But using these two strategies lead you to implement a robust security system in your application.
Assume that I am going to send you a message and I want to encrypt it so that meanwhile I am sending, no one else can see that message. So with using the public key, I encrypt it, and with private key that you only have, you can decrypt it. Therefore, with two different keys, we can have secure communication. Okay. All right. So this is symmetric key. It is used both for encryption and decryption, and this is asymmetric encryption. I use public key to encrypt. Anyone can encrypt any message with public key. However, only who has the private key can decrypt it. Okay. You may look for more information related to this because it is an advanced topic.
Implementing symmetric cryptography in your C# application. One of the most popular symmetric algorithms is AES, Advanced Encryption Security. You can find all the cryptography classes in System, Security, Cryptography namespace. In this tutorial, I will use AES algorithm to encrypt a piece of plain text and save it into a file and also read this file and decrypt its content to a plain text.
Okay, so what we need is we need to have methods for encryption and decryption. So let's add a public class here. Oh, incorrect click. Okay, I will call it as custom encryption. Do I type it? Oh, okay. Okay, I'm going to make this as public static. I'm going to type the methods here. Okay, I will make them public. Encrypt text, decrypt text. Let's add the related libraries. Cryptography and IO. Okay, so you see, the encrypt text takes as algorithm parameter string text and file name. Then the encryption takes the same. So let's see how it is provided. Okay, so let's go back to our application. Okay, to be able to use it, I need to add the library here. All right. Then you see we generate symmetric algorithm as IIS managed, and we define a key array. Key property contains the key of IIS algorithm. You can create your own. Okay, get source sets the symmetric algorithm key. All right, and yeah, we need a key. So the secret key, let's set our key as how we're gonna set it equal to, how can we set it? It is byte. I see. So what we need to do is my custom key, let's compose a custom key. Key. I will make two keys so you will understand. Let's say string. I can also make this read only. Okay, and I will compose it to byte array. To compose it byte array, how do we do that? I don't remember. Because it is a byte array. Okay, let's check it out. Okay, let's use encoding. Yeah, like this. And the string is here. You see, I can write an extension for the string. Let's write an extension. Okay, public static to byte array. It will take this dot string and it will return a byte array, of course. Okay, then let's copy and paste this. And here, test string, whatever you want. Okay, now we have our extension. And I will just use this to byte array. All right. You see now it says the namespace does not exist, so I will add here as using static lecture 12 dot custom encryption. Okay, now those methods are available. All right, now we have defined our key from here. And we need a custom message to encrypt. Let's say my special text to be sent to school. Okay, whatever. And we are going to compose an encrypted file. I will write it into a TXT file so we can see it. And for decryption, this time I will use a different key and see that we can decrypt or not. Okay, I will change the key before I provide decryption. For example, let's make some other key. Okay, so let's run the application. You see, if you use a different key, you won't be able to decrypt that message. Without having this key, I have to use brute force until I find this key to decrypt this message. Otherwise, it is impossible. Okay, let's try symmetric encryption. Oh, we have this is incorrect. Button click. Yeah. Also, let's fix its name. Okay, let's run the application. Oh, where did it go? One moment. Let's get back its position. Okay. All right. Okay, now we can test. Okay, you see, specified key is not valid size for this algorithm. Interesting. It has worked for. Oh, I see. So you see, since this is a byte array, since the array size has changed, it has thrown error, but it is fine. We will fix it. So let's see how our encrypted text is looking. Binary and encrypted data. You see, it is something like this. It is impossible to make sense of it. And let's compose another key. AS2, AS2, and AS2. Okay, let's run it. And let's put a breakpoint here. Okay, specified key is not valid for this algorithm. This is interesting. Why? What is the difference between this one and this one? Byte 16, byte 32. So this is being too long or what? Let's use another algorithm than IS. What are our options? Sniff. Okay, there is IS dash RS2 triple dash regime bell. Key size. This is interesting. Why we can set as we want. Okay, there is key size and key. It should work, but why it is not working? So it is, I see, it is 256 bits, therefore I have to reduce my key size. Let's try like this. If it is 32 bytes, that means that is, well, it should work. Interesting, really interesting. Okay, block size, feedback size, key size. Default key size is 32 bytes. key size value ve key value ve okay. But this one is working, however. Okay, I will check something else. Okay, it is null. And once I initialize it, it has by default. Okay, like this, and it has some key here. And when I override the key, okay, it changes. All right, it encrypts. Then when I compose AES2, okay, it works. All right, so let's do something else. And see what is the issue. Maybe we need to compose something different. Oh, I see. So this is an invalid size. You see, it is 13 bytes. Therefore, I have to complete it to at least 16 bytes or 32 bytes. To fix that, I am going to write another method extension. Okay, public static byte. 32 bytes. Okay, what this is going to do is it will take a byte array, and then it will compose a byte array of equal to new array, byte array, 32. Then with for loop, we can do it. Length. Okay, assign the values. By default, the rest of the values will be zero. Okay, however, we will have the values assigned correctly. And so the first example was magically 16 bytes array, therefore it has worked. And let's return. Okay, then we will add this. Okay, this is method cascading. Okay, now it should work. All right, let's run the application. Okay, now you see padding is invalid. You see, we have got error of decryption because we have provided different key, therefore we have got an error. So if I provide the same key, I should get it working. This causes error. Okay, so I will copy and paste it. You know, I can add that try and catch and prevent errors, but I will not do it right now. I will just provide the correct key with the same IS, and now we should be able to decrypt it. So this is symmetric encryption. with custom key. Now it works, you see, it is working. Then let's see the asymmetric one here. We will just use almost the same thing. Encrypt. Okay, let's add them to our encryption class. This time I will add encrypt A. And let's add decrypt asymmetric. Okay, so this time it is getting a public key, and for decryption it gets a private key. So the difference, I think it will come the difference in the here, for of course asymmetric and asymmetric data, we will use different algorithm. This time we are going to use RSA, and it will get public and private keys. Let's say, okay, SR public key. And it's our private key. And okay, and to be able to use it, okay, public key RSA to XML string. False. How it is going to know that we have the correct public and private key? Let's check it out. Okay, this guy is not providing private and public keys. So to be able to provide them, what we need is RSA dot okay, there are some things, I think. Let's see, key size decrypt. From XML sync. From the key information from an XML string. Imports a public private key pair from a PKS found RSA private key structure. Okay, this is more advanced data, advanced algorithm. So we need to import our public and private keys. To import it, I will import private key, and it takes read only span byte. And out int bytes read. So we need now read only span. Okay, this is interesting. Let's try. Two byte array. Then I need to convert it to read only span. C sharp read only span. I have never used read only span, so I have no idea. Let's look from Stagor. Okay. How to get read only span from read only struct? I see. So this is a property. Public static unsafe read on the span byte get span. Yeah, let's use this method. Maybe it will work, I'm not sure. Okay. Read only span public static get span. If we remove this, what happens? Okay, it says that allow unsafe code. If we remove this, what happens? We have string. No, not working. Sharp string to read only span. Let's try to find this way. Okay, there is implicit and explicit string to read only span character array. Let's check from here, maybe. And as a private key, and I will make this as byte, not character. Okay, it doesn't see read only span. Oh, because we are using it incorrectly. Let's try to use it like this, and okay. Cannot convert type string to read only span byte. Okay. Try base 64 characters. Convert try from base 64 characters. No, this is not what we want. Convert to, there is no read only span. Okay, encoding gets read only span bytes. I see. So we need okay, we need, I think, a library from NuGet probably. Okay. String to read on this one. Yeah, how do we do that? It supports character but not byte. When I do like this, it works. However, this time we are not able to set the private key because it takes byte. Maybe I can convert character to byte. So I provide like this. Let's see if it will work. Okay. Okay, then I will convert them to this is already an array. Therefore, what I need is I need to add linQ. LinQ is added. Yes. So select. There is no select. Okay, let's first comment this part and see what we get from this conversion. It says we have some errors. What errors do we have? Yeah, we don't need this. Okay. So this is basically an array of characters like this, right? Oh no. Then what I need to do is I need to convert character to the byte, I think. Yeah, this is only it is. Let's move this into our other thing and read only byte this time. Key will be equal to our private key to char array length and okay. So this will be the size of byte array. This is interesting. It doesn't take byte array, but it only spawn byte. What is this? Maybe something like this. And it has length empty to array copy slice contains and what else start since it is read only I cannot change it obviously so I have to compose it somehow Oh, maybe this is possible. Let's try it. Put on. It's a private key. So, byte array. Does this work? Okay, it is working. Great. Great. Now we have our private key set. Okay, and let's set our public key as well. And that's our public key. Okay, let's set our import. Public key. By the way, for this to work, you need to have a remote server where you will generate the RSA and provide it. Okay. Or you will provide the public key. Yeah, you need to provide the RSA without the private key. Okay, that is the correct thing. Okay, we have generated our public key and private key. Then can we export the public key, private key, equal to RSA export private key. Okay, it is able to export private key. Then we can encrypt the data as encrypt asymmetric. Okay, it is not public, I see. Here. Okay, so string public key, string text file. We also need to set the private key, otherwise there is no reason to use it. Let's say this example is not good one. However, we get the idea. How to get the private key? Okay, how to get the public key? Then okay, so we have public key test data encryption like this. Client encrypted data with public key issued by server. Okay. Encrypted data base encrypted return encrypted. Okay, decryption. Then there is a private key. Okay, this still doesn't answer. Okay, araya say crypto service provider here. So this is public private XML and hello world encrypt then. Encrypt using exported keys. Private XML. I see, so this is how it is done. Okay, so however, this is not what we want. Anyway, you get the idea. It is getting too long. So I will leave it to you to find the answer and fix yourself. Okay, it is already 2 hours. This is private parameters and this is public parameters. Then sign data with plain text by signature. This is still not explaining. This is also not the answer that I wanted. This is also verify signature. We don't need that. We need we need to encrypt with public key. Okay, there's a make a key which makes private key public key, then public key string. Let's try this because this one looks better. String public static private key public static void make key okay this is the public key okay I see now okay once we have it public static void. Okay, now it will work. Okay, with this way, we can use public key to encrypt. We can see it here. It is using only public key for encryption and for decryption. It will use the private key. Okay, this is the correct way. Now we have the correct encryption and decryption. To make it work, I will call first make key. Then I can call encryption and decryption with file path, for example. Okay, text to text test. Okay, let's add something to it. No, test, whatever. Let's encrypt this. So we will be providing this for encryption, and then for decryption takes also the file, then writes it. Okay, private key string reader file path. Okay, so and I will show you what how does it work like this. Okay, so we don't need this anymore. Let's run it. Okay, once I execute to make key, there will be keys. You see private key. It is like this, an XML file and public key. So I will send public key to the person who I want to encrypt message and send me. Then with public key, that person will be able to encrypt my message. Okay, there is an error. What is the error? Bad length. Interesting. Why? This shouldn't. Okay, it appears that okay, this is still not working. I see. But you get the idea now. It is something like this. I will fix this one moment. Okay, so the logic is simple actually. We were making it more complex. So what we need is we are going to export our public and private key at the server side, for example. Export. Then we will export only public key as well. Okay, this will be public key. Okay, so okay, include private parameters, no. So this will be public key. Key, and this will be private key. I mean, this will be private key and this will be private key. And then we will encrypt with public key only. So you see this is encrypting with public key, and then with private key we will decrypt it. Okay, so let's try it. So we will share only public key, and the private key will be staying at the server. Then we can use that private key to decrypt and public key to encrypt. So we never share our private key with anyone else, but just we share only our public key. Okay, this is our private key. As you can see, it is bigger and it also includes public key. And then we have our public key. You see it is lesser. Then we encrypt with using only public key. Here our encrypted data, and here our encrypted data. This is our encrypted RSA. Then we generate another instance of RSA 2, and we use this time private key to decrypt, and it is decrypted. Okay, this is that simple. We were just making it complex. Okay, and let's write our new things. Okay, I'm going to fix the keyboards. Such as, okay, for example, our symmetric algorithm is IAS. Okay. How to asymmetrically encrypt data with using asymmetric algorithms such as RSA. Okay. And okay, hopefully next week I will start showing you example of how to do a multi-threaded crawling. So I'm going to take extra note here. Okay, gzip compression. Okay. Okay, if you have any questions, contact me from Discord or email. Okay, and we have casting. How to do implicit and explicit casting and converting. Okay, it's fine. So let's upload our source code. Sometimes I'm forgetting it. Okay. Okay, end of lecture 12. Hopefully see you next week.